Good morning. My name is Paul Giannelli, so I'm an evidence teacher at Case, and my research interests have been in scientific evidence. And so we're going to have a presentation today on DNA evidence. I was the reporter for the American Bar Association standards on DNA evidence. So I'm going to use, obviously, the PowerPoint presentation to cue my comments. So DNA, the structure of DNA is identified by the scientists in 1953, Crick and Watson. But its first forensic use is in 1985 in the United Kingdom. It's introduced the next year into American trials. Have the early cases, Andrews, the first reported case, Pellet case. Typically with new scientific evidence, though, there was no defense attorney, and there was not much of a challenge in that case. The first real challenge comes in this Castro case. Barry Scheck and Peter Neufeld challenged it. And they didn't challenge the underlying science. They challenged how it was being used. And DNA originally started in private laboratories. Today it's run by the government, and there are a number of private laboratories, but at that time it was completely a private enterprise. There's a early scientific dispute besides the procedures, and that's on the statistics, the population genetics, and I'll come back and I'll talk about that in a few minutes. The National Academy of Sciences had to write two reports. The first one, so these are the top scientists in the country. The first one was on the technology or the DNA, but there was criticism on their practical suggestion. And then there was a second policy. This is the power of DNA, because you can get it from any cell that has a nucleus, and that's most of your cells. Well, some cells, like your red blood cells, don't have a nuclei, but the white cells in the serum does. So blood, semen are the most common, but you could do saliva, even on a bite mark. They take the saliva, they've taken it off stamps. Sweat, they'll take it off ski masks. They go all sweatbands on baseball caps and things like that. Teeth, fingernails, skeletal remains, and dandruff. So you're all going around here shedding your DNA all the time, because you're shedding your skin, and in your skin there's cells, and that's the DNA. There's a second, and that's, let me go back, that's nuclear DNA, okay? So we're going into the nucleus. There's a second type of DNA. The second type of DNA is mitochondrial DNA. This is not as powerful. It's not as discriminating. But it's very helpful for the situations where you cannot get the regular nuclear DNA. So the shaft, hair shaft, if it has a root or a skin tag on it, if it's pulled out, use regular DNA. If not, if somebody drops out, then you can use mitochondrial DNA, bones, if you don't have the marrow of a skeletonized. And so it's important, it's not as discriminatory, but it's better than anything we've had before, for instance, for hair. This is just the human cell. And the critical part, the mitochondria is out here, so we get mitochondrial DNA. You inherit that from your mother only, where nuclear DNA you get alleles or genetic characteristics from your mother, one from your mother, one from your father. And so everybody in your family is going to have, on your mother's side, go back, have the same mitochondrial DNA. Not true on your nuclear DNA. The nuclear DNA is found in the chromosomes. All right. So this is the picture that is the most important, because this is the double helix. If you cut this in half or you zipper it apart, you look at these base pairs. Okay, and each of the base pairs, A and T, are always associated with each other, and G and C. So they all come. It's very simple and elegant in that sense. And this is what controls everything in the human in human life. What kind of hair you have, what kind of eyes you have, and so forth. And so what we're going to do is if you stretch this out, the DNA from one person, it's about my height. And so there's, you know, millions of these base pairs. And what you want to do is you want to go to certain sites. And for the national database, you go to 13 sites. So these are just loci sites on the DNA chain. And we're going to count these base pairs. And the base pairs are like this. How they match up. It's really a two-step process. And so the molecular biology component, declaring a match, is the first part. And the second is, once you have a match, but you have to use the word match in quotes, a match at each loci. It's got to be a match at each loci. If you go to 13 loci, and there's one loci where there's not a match, it's an exclusion. So it's much easier to exclude somebody than to include them. It's more definite. You never get to the second part. You never get to the population genetics. All right, there's been at least three generations of DNA. If you go look back at the old DNA cases and stuff, we're concerned about, this is the most current test, STRs, and this is what you do. You go to the DNA, and there's the base pairs, and you'll see here this five repeats. That's where they get it short, you know, four or five bases, and it repeats at this certain loci. And they want to go, obviously, you want to go to a place where there's lots of variation. Human beings have a lot of variation. Most of our DNA is all the same. So you want to go in those places where humans have different alleles. These are each allele. So and somebody might have 19 repeats and somebody else might have 10. This is what it looks like at the end is electropherogram. And these are just three sites on the DNA. And so we're going to go on the national database, 13 sites, and in a crime scene working, they can go to 16 sites. And so if you look here, this tells you at this location, all right, this is what the human beings have. They divide into these groups, 12 repeats, 15 repeats, 18. And at this site, we've got more variation and even more at this location. And you get one allele from your mother, one from your father. So if you get a 24 and a 25, all right, that's, you get one from your mother, one from your father. Here, same thing, two alleles. Here, you're homozygous. That is, you get the same from both, your father and your mother. So if we have these, this is what the crime scene evidence shows at these three locations. If one of those does not match the suspect, it's an exclusion. It's an exclusion. We've got 13 in the CODIS loci. There can be interpretation issues. I don't want to say that this is perfect. There are some interpretation issues in some cases. A lot of cases are not much of an interpretation problem. And there can be a subjective element to it. All right, so scientists did this for me, Statistics 101. This is the key. If we get a match at each of the loci, each place, and here, let's suppose it's just four. All right, so we know that the odds, one and two at each place, and they're independent of each other. That's the critical point. They're independent of each other, so we know that the odds of getting all four are one in 16. So this is a lottery example doing the same thing. And essentially, using 1 through 10, with 10, and you can see all of a sudden you're up to a, you know, one in a million chances to get all the lottery the same. And DNA is the same set. If we use the 13 DNA, and if you've, this is taking an average, it's not bad, one out of 20 person has this, you know, it's a genetic marker, could be like blue eyes or brown hair, whatever, and you add it up, you can get up to this, you know, there's only 6 billion, 7 billion people in the world, so you can get this tremendous statistic. So it's not positive. You can't say it's this person to the exclusion of everybody else, but the statistics can be that high that it is, you know, realistically, it is a positive identification. So the summary here is just that you're using a fairly common characteristics taken together, get a red DNA profile. So that's the basic profile. Yes?
Paul, what do you mean in the term of science and exclusion? You used that term a couple of times.
Okay, so, let me, so take the ABO blood type. So in North America, you're either going to have, well, any place, but in North America, we just have the four things. You're either A blood or B blood or AB blood or O blood. And we know the statistics. So, but if we find O blood at the scene and I have A blood, I'm excluded. That's all I was saying. I don't match up.
It's the common meaning of the word.
Right, yeah. It's not the person. It's not the person. And on the other hand, if you have AB blood and at the scene and the defendant has AB blood, we know only 3% of the population has AB blood. But if there's a million people in the area, there's 30,000 people with the AB blood. What DNA does, it just takes that down smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller, so we can say, well, it's a random match probability. If we went out into the community and we randomly took the DNA, you know, one in a billion, one in a million, you could have a partial profile. You could have only six because the, you know, forensic use, the crime scene, it can be degraded. So, you know, that's an issue. And just speak up if you have questions. All right, so it's not just the DNA itself. It's DNA combined with computer technology. And this is the national database is called CODIS. It's run by the FBI. So the first database was started in Virginia in 1989. This is the critical thing. In 1994, Congress passes the DNA Identification Act, and they set up this national database. Each state legislates its targets. And so what happens is, like Cuyahoga County does DNA for us. So the DNA from Cuyahoga County is going to be uplifted to the state database. And from the state database, I forget, maybe it's on a Thursday, all the states uplift, you know, to the FBI database. And then the FBI runs it. So you're running against forensic samples, that's crime scene samples, and you're running against known offenders. And they can get a hit, a cold hit. I mean, that's the value. Without a suspect, we have no suspect in this case, we can get a cold hit. The controversial part of it was who should be in the database. All right, so they started with all offenders, all sex offenders, obviously. Then they went to felonies. Then they tried to, some went to misdemeanors. I saw the Virginia statistics once, and people were identified. They were putting in misdemeanors all, and so people were in there for, you know, bad checks and things like that, forgery, things you don't associate with violent crimes, but they were getting hits in violent cases. And so the argument is who should be in there. Few states went to all arrestees. Some people have argued we ought to have a universal database, everybody, because we take blood samples of kids at birth for checking for certain diseases that if you identify early, you can cure, but if you don't, you can have terrible consequences. That was a controversial issue. We don't have the funds to do this, so that's pie in the sky. Then the question is, should you put juveniles in a database? Most of them do, and even somebody who's not guilty by reason of insanity. There are privacy issues, okay? That from the beginning, there have been privacy issues. You're starting a national database. And so people would bring up the fact Social Security numbers were supposed to be private. We know how private they are. Your tax is supposed to be private, but sometimes not. So there are some built-in privacy protections because all you get in your database is a VIN code. So you take those numbers I showed you on the electropherogram, and you take it at each site, and you just put the numbers in. So if you saw somebody's number, that's all you'll see. You'll just see this long number. It doesn't help you at all. What happens if the FBI gets a hit from an Ohio offender, and he get a hit in a Virginia case, they notify Virginia. Then Virginia has to contact Ohio. Ohio has the code, whose DNA, and the identifying characteristic, who is the person with that DNA. Then they will tell Virginia, okay, they're going to issue a search warrant for this person or follow other investigative leads, but they certainly got probable cause now to get a search warrant. They're going to get a fresh sample, and they're going to do the test again to do it. And they go under parts of the DNA chain. They used to call it junk DNA because they didn't know what it did. But the problem is eventually we think we will know what even these areas do, that they just sit there. Nobody knows what their function is as far as any kind of a disease or anything like that. So it's another protection. There's criminal penalties for disclosing this data. It's really not the code that raises a privacy issue. It is the blood sample. If you have somebody's blood sample, then you have their DNA. And if you have your DNA, you can find out, you know, does this person have what kind of diseases and so forth. So that's really the privacy issue with the databases. So this is the Identification Act, and this is interesting because this is the first time the federal government is regulating a forensic science. They have to have regulations because they're afraid they're going to get junk in their database and they're going to get misidentifications. And this is the some of the issues on the post-conviction testing. So in New York was the first to permit post-conviction testing. That was in 1993. And then Illinois, in about 1999, they had eight cases, death penalty cases, where they had exonerations through DNA. So they had a commission on their capital punishment, and they came out with this post-conviction testing. Now just about every state has some sort of post-conviction testing because there's no legal process. I mean, lots of times they have to go to the governor and ask the governor for a pardon, but lots of times you can't get the DNA. A lot of the DNA was never preserved, all right? Only now are people preserving biological evidence. If you do preserve it, you can go back 50, 60 years of evidence if it hasn't been degraded and it's been kept and test it. And so you do have cases like that. So I think about 300, I looked the other day, there's been about 314 people who've been exonerated through DNA technology through the Innocence Project. all the affiliates of the Innocence Project. I think 18 of those, about 18, my memory serves me, were death penalty cases. These people were on death row. And so the DNA is used, obviously, in crimes of violence. You're going to see it, rapes, assault, murders. So these are the most usual crimes where the DNA evidence is used. They have been trying to expand it to other things. They had a pilot program, what they call low copy DNA, only six cells. That's really small, obviously, and you have to really worry about cross-contamination. But they were trying to use it in vehicles, so they're, car thefts. Obviously, the steering wheel is not a good place to test for. But back up where the ignition is, if somebody jumps the car and stuff, you look for the DNA there and try to see if the same people committing the crime over and over again. So these were controversial because the question was who should get this, and we on the ABA we had to deal with this problem. Some of the questions were, we focused just people who are currently in prison. What about the people who were out on parole, etc.? Should they have, they could have records, they could be registered sex offenders and have been wrongfully imprisoned. So that was a problem. Guilty pleas. So some people argue that anybody who pled guilty shouldn't have access to DNA. The problem is we found out that a lot of the, 20% of the cases of exonerations have false confessions in them. And these are usually juveniles or they are people who have cognitive disabilities. And so once you get a confession, then sometimes the best thing to do is to plead guilty, especially if you're facing a death penalty. So the ABA said, no, that shouldn't preclude you. The time limitations. The prosecutors were concerned that they could open up the floodgates. Everybody's going to be claiming DNA. That has not developed, really, on these old cases. And now there's a time period because these cases will... now the prosecution, on recent cases, the prosecution is using DNA. So you're not getting these cases in the trial. You're not getting the cases, all the old cases you're looking for. Some of the old cases, they had DNA, but they had the early types of DNA. So we have a more robust technology now, so you can test those, okay? But the cases now, the prosecution's doing the testing and they're using it to convict. There is and Congress passed the Innocence Protection Act. It gives money for the states to set up these programs. The disincentives. One of the problems with the post-conviction DNA testing is that in a rape case, the victim has moved on in many cases. So you're reopening this old wound because under the victim, most of the victim rights statutes, any proceeding affecting that case, you have to go back and inform the victim of the case. So that was a concern. On the other hand, if you've got somebody who is innocent, that's also a major concern. I did ask, at one time I asked, how many people the Innocence Project, when they send their DNA in, does it confirm that the guy's guilty? And it's 40, it was something like 40%. I was just saying, what are these guys gaming the system? What do they think? They have nothing to lose. And what I was told is many of the times it's really the family who is pushing to get the DNA test. The guy's telling his family that he's innocent, and the family's the one pushing it and stuff. And so eventually, if they get the testing done, a lot of the cases, they can't do testing because they can't find the evidence. It hasn't been preserved. And it can be easy if prosecutors are, there's some prosecutors are very proactive. They set up their own DNA units and said they'll retest any of the case of anybody in prison that was done in San Diego. Other prosecutors will fight like crazy, and that's why you have these acts, which will require them to do the DNA testing. There are other problems, legal problems. One is on the statute of limitations. So in many states, it's statute of limitations. Obviously, for murder, there's no statute of limitations. But 6 years for, rape. And so, not in Ohio. Ohio's now, used to be this, but Ohio went to 20 years, but that was back on the child molestation cases was really the reason for this. And, the kid not reporting the sexual abuse and molestation until they're a teenager or something like that. So Ohio has changed that. Anyway, so you don't see the same problem. The problem here is the argument against it, this is not a constitutional argument. Statute of limitations are not constitutionally required. But there is a due process argument about staleness, and the staleness of the evidence makes it very hard for a defendant to defend against this. You know, where were you? What's your alibi, 15 years ago? But on the other hand, with DNA, the argument is the evidence is robust. It is very reliable. And therefore, if we can go back and take somebody out of prison and test, because reopen a case, the counterpart should be we should also be willing to prosecute somebody on DNA. So what you do here, and this has been done in Ohio, according to the newspapers, is they are indicting by your DNA code. So you always had John Doe indictments, but a John Doe indictment has to describe the person. So you don't know the name of this person, but you describe them as best you can. And so that's been around for a long time. Here, how they're going to identify the person is through his DNA. All right. So this has been, and this has happened in Cuyahoga County. They've done this on several of these cases. I'm going to stop. I'm going to ask some questions, take questions now, and then I have a couple other things I can talk about. Yep.
What is the cost of maintaining a DNA database and doing the testing on a per case basis?
The testing is used to be very expensive, but not now that it's really automated. So I don't know the exact cost, but there was a time you could do it even recently for like $1,000 at a private lab. Well, they can do it for a lot less at a government lab that does a lot of these testing. Setting up the whole database, I have no idea. I mean, that's this huge thing. There's millions and millions of people in these databases. The databases not only have offender files in them and forensic files in it, they also have a missing person files. So if people are, kids that are missing and stuff, then they have a separate file for them. Are there any other questions? Yeah.
Wasn't there a time Cuyahoga was supposed to get its own crime lab? Did we get it? So that we could do our own testing up here without going to clones.
Right. They had the DNA capability when we had the coroner system here at the county coroner's office. The county coroner's office is sort of unusual here. Well, New York City's the same, is that the DNA was the coroner. Now it's a medical examiner's office when we switched the county setup and went to an executor instead of commissioners in the county. We switched to a medical examiner's office, which is the same thing as and they have a... So they have not only a DNA capability, they've had it for years, They have the trace evidence is done there, and they are now bringing over, expanding that from the city police, you know, the firearms people and so forth. So, yes, Cuyahoga County has a, you know, a good DNA testing facility. And Ohio was lucky. They hired a really good person when they set up their system. And so I think Ohio is in very good shape that way. The main problem, and you see this in the newspapers all the time now, the main problem is that there are all these rape kits that have not been tested. And so what Congress has done over the years, you'll see this DNA backlog, part of the 1994 legislation, besides the Innocent Protection Act and the DNA Identification Act, another part of that legislation was money to do the backlog. Because you can outsource, it's easy enough to outsource the offender testing, because those are on pure samples. You're just getting buckle swabs from a defendant, and you're doing their DNA. So you can outsource that to private companies. The forensic crime scene is more difficult because it could be your blood and dirt. You could have mixed samples. You have mixed samples in rape cases, so you have to separate the epithelial cells from the woman, from the sperm cells from the man. But there is a cold case. It's been on for a couple of years. You're reading the paper. A couple of weeks ago, they had a trial where they're going back and they're going to look at, I think it was 4,000 cases from Cleveland. But what happened in those cases, I mean, and this is not just Cleveland. Houston had 20,000 untested rape kits. Well, you have to understand what that means. That means that there are rapists out there that we could have identified years ago committing new rapes. So there were women who were raped, same in Cleveland, because you sat on those things, who didn't have to be raped. We could have identified this guy on an earlier rape and hopefully would have prosecuted. The one they had last week was sort of, 2 weeks ago, was sort of controversial because the victim did not want, apparently, didn't want to testify. And I think the paper said they issued a material witness warrant to force her to come in. And this guy's on death row already for another crime, and he has some other rape convictions. So the argument is, why are you doing this, and is it a waste of money? I think it's important, though, and I don't know the facts of this case, and so I'm sympathetic about a case where maybe we don't need it. What the prosecutors worry about is that this conviction is going to get overturned on appeal or something. And the other reason you do these old cases is that many of the victims, even though the statute of limitations has run, they want to know that the person who attacked them is now incarcerated someplace, all right? That he's not just out there wandering around and coming back. So I've seen a lot of the reports where the rape victims are very happy to find out, even though they can't be prosecuted for their case, they're very happy that they find out that this person has been identified. Some of these cases, there used to be in Maryland, Silver Springs, many of you know, is just one of the suburbs of Washington, D.C. It's in Maryland, but it's right outside of Washington, D.C. And there was a rapist there, the Silver Spring rapist. And 30 years after his first rape, he was identified through a DNA database. And this guy but had rapes, 25 rapes in 30 years. And those are the rapes, there could be more because these are the rapes the evidence was admitted or into the database. In 25 rapes over 30 years, not just in Maryland, but in New Jersey and New York. So that's another valuable thing about the databases. Even if you don't have a suspect, if all of a sudden you see that we have a serial rapist here, this person has
has raped five or six people, then you're looking for a different type of suspect. I don't know if you remember the West Side rapists we had here in the 1980s. Didn't have the DNA. But somebody like that, once he's in, if we get his DNA one place, you can connect him and find him sooner. I think he wants to put it on, because we're on a podcast, so.
Is the same test that was used, the threshold test for the admissibility of DNA evidence, the test that was used to admit fingerprint evidence many years ago? And what is the legal status of the science of fingerprint evidence?
One of the things that happened in this area of forensic science, DNA had another effect. DNA it came out of science, where fingerprints and question documents, firearms identification, what we call ballistics, they came out of crime labs. And so, there is no other use for fingerprints except for legal use and firearms identification, just used to solve crimes. So DNA comes along, we said, in the second half of the 1980s and so forth, and we have these admissibility battles, and eventually DNA comes in. And then people say, well, you've got all this research and literature, and we got the scientific community who supports DNA. And as I said, we don't make positive identifications with DNA. We only report random match probabilities. Fingerprints say they can match it to the person, to the exclusion of all other people, and there isn't the same kind of research at all. The second thing that happens that in around this time, 1993, the Supreme Court of the United States decides the Daubert case, and that changes the legal standard for admissibility. It only applies in the federal courts, but many states have picked that up. So there's a whole new approach to scientific evidence, and certainly in civil cases, it really has raised the standard as to what's admissible in federal courts in civil cases. Ironically, it hasn't had the same effect in criminal cases. What happened with the old test is the first fingerprint test reported case is out of Illinois in 1911, and they didn't have any test for admissibility. And it was used originally, that's the first used at a crime scene, but fingerprints were originally used for identification of people you arrest, and they give you aliases. And that's way before 1911, not way before, but it's in the end of the 19th century. The English came up with that in India. But you needed all 10 fingerprints. And you don't get that at a crime scene most of the time. Its use as a identification technique as evidence comes later. So if I'm arrested, they can take my fingerprints, and they use this formula back then. And if my fingerprints are on file with the FBI or locally, you can make identification. But you needed all 10. Okay, the fingerprints are revolutionized through the computer as well. We have APHIS. So APHIS does the hard work, searching all the fingerprints. And so you can get cold hits with fingerprints. But this evidence was not vetted the same way. We didn't have the high standards. And since the evidence, fingerprints and everything else was admitted for all these years, there was no incentive, and the government's the only people who would give you the money to do this, for the government to research fingerprints, because everybody was happy. It was working, it was accepted, the courts let it in, and so forth. After DNA, after Daubert, first it was handwriting, first case 1995, a federal case attacking handwriting, then fingerprints in about 2000, and then firearms identification. What we found out with these other forensic techniques is that the experts have really oversold it in their testimony. Some of the testimony is just, you know, bogus. We found out arson testimony for years, bogus. Hair evidence, microscopic hair evidence, not mitochondrial hair evidence. So when a fingerprint expert, and they did this for years, and a firearms expert or a question document expert, if they testify this is the person to the exclusion of all of the people in the world, that is a false or an incorrect statement. There's no scientific basis for them to make that statement. That's an assumption on their part. It has never been proven. So they shouldn't be testifying that way anymore in cases. They say that they're 100% certain. That is not a scientific statement either. To understand fingerprints, because that is a mystique, if even if you assume that my finger, this one fingerprint, is unique, and that's an assumption, all right, that's not what we're asking. That's not how the evidence is used. What we're doing is asking about this friction ridge, that's what they call those little lines on your finger, it's a transfer, it's an impression of, and so in Europe they call it a fingerprint mark, because they don't want to get the impression, the fingerprint impression mixed up with the actual fingerprint, the friction ridge on it. So in any of those glasses out there, where you're drinking the water, if you look at those glasses, you can often see fingerprints. They're going to be smudged. That's because you're gripping them. So every time somebody puts down a fingerprint, first of all, it's a partial fingerprint. So if you get a record fingerprint, when they want to be a lawyer or in the Army, I had my fingerprints taken, you know, they have this 1 inch by 1 inch. But you're only getting 20% of that usually on a, so it's going to be a partial print. It's going to be distorted. And there's going to be parts, because of the distortion, that you can't see. So the fingerprint examiner is looking at something that's objective, but the ultimate decision is subjective. And there are no points in the United States. Some countries have, you need 16 points of identification. There are no points needed to make that, and there's no standard for fingerprints. Okay, so you could argue powerfully, and I have, that's not science, all right? I'm not saying that it's not reliable under certain circumstances. I think it is. But what we've never done is we haven't figured out the limitations of the fingerprint technique. Hair evidence was another one. Well, hair evidence, all they could say is it's consistent with your hair. So it was never a positive identification. So we have two problems with hair evidence. One is, what does it mean to say it's consistent with? I mean, is that like saying, well, the suspect, defendant has a nose and the guy who robbed the bank has a nose, okay? So all of you know that that's not very impressive. But with hair evidence, you don't know that. You don't have that background. If you took a footprint of a Nike size 9, at least you have some background to say, okay, there's, you know, maybe there's a million of those out there, but it has some probative value because it shrinks the class of people who could have contributed to that footprint. Well, that's what you couldn't do with hair. There's no way to tell the jury. If they were honest, they could say, well, it could be somebody else, or it could be a couple thousand, a couple million, because they hadn't done the research. So that's one problem. And the defense counsel let it come in without really going after it. And the other thing is they would get into court and they would say, go way beyond what they're supposed to say in their lab report. And that's because the lawyers, us, push them to say as much as you can. And so they would say, well, maybe there's somebody else in the world. Well, that's just totally false. It could be millions of people in the world. We just don't know. I mean, when you say it could be one other person, that's like DNA evidence, okay, and this is not. So they didn't use any of those tests back then. And now they're trying to catch up, and they're cutting down on some of the testimony. Some of the testimony has been replaced. You know, mitochondrial DNA has replaced the hair analysis if it's a serious case, so they can do that. Okay, other DNA questions. Let me talk about some other things. Last year, a case called Maryland versus King, the Supreme Court of the United States upheld arrestee databases. So this guy's arrested in Maryland. He's not convicted. He's just arrested. And if it's a serious offense, then it can go into the database. And that was a major step. And so you're going to have predict that, that other states are going to change that, and you're going to have arrestee database. The problem with that, and the ABA, I was there for the arguments about it, is you can be arrested by one police officer's determination of probable cause without a warrant. So you have one person, and you're arrested, and then you're in this, and you're in this database. Where if you had a conviction, obviously, you know, that's going to be far more reliable. And if you legally get in the database, you can't get out unless you are acquitted, and then you have to move to expunge. Even an acquittal in some states, you cannot get your DNA out of the system. So that was a major change. It's going to open up these databases. The British have never had that limitation, so they don't have the same Fourth Amendment protections. They started earlier. I saw once a statistic years ago that one-third of the males in Britain from like 19 to 36 are in their database because you could get somebody on suspicion and bring them in. So that's a real civil liberties issue, but it's been determined by the Supreme Court. Another privacy issue that has been raised deals with what's known as familial DNA searches of the database. So this the first case that I saw reported was this woman was raped in about 1988 in the UK. And the UK at this time is gearing up their databases. So they put the crime scene evidence into the database. In the early 1990s, and 10 years later or whatever, a long time later, they don't get a hit. As I said, every loci has to match to have a positive, you know, to say that this is the person or this is the this could be the person. Then we have to work the statistics out. But usually if it doesn't miss, it misses 13, maybe only 4 match. But this case had like 9 of the sites matched. And as soon as you see that, you know it's not the person in the database, but you think it's a relative, because that's a pretty big match. And the kid in the database is 14 years old. He wasn't even born at the time of the rape. I mean, so, but his DNA didn't match, but they figured it's got to be a close relative. And so they focused in on his family, they found out all the males in the family, they investigated further, and bingo, they hit the, his uncle was the person who committed the rape. All right, so even if you're not in the database, if one of your relatives is in the database, it expands the match. There's a best case in the United States to illustrate this. A couple of years ago, this guy was the Grim Reaper in Los Angeles. 10 killings, but it was over a 25-year period, and he had times when he wasn't active. So they ran a search, and they get a hit for this guy named, his last name is Franklin. And they didn't get a perfect hit, which is what you look for, but they got a close hit. So it's not this guy. He's in there on a weapons charge, but they figured it's a relative. And so what they do is they start investigating, find out who his relatives are. They focus in on his father. And then they wait till he goes and eats, gets a pizza, and he throws it away, doesn't finish it. They go in and pick it up. And they test it, and they've got their match. So that's a familiar testing. So that's another way that these databases are expanding. In one sense, it was always true for identical twins. Okay, everybody's DNA is different except for identical twins. So if identical twins in there, then the other one's DNA is in there as well. There's several other Fourth Amendment issues. One is, you see this all the time. So you're leaving these glasses here that you drank out of, and the police are looking, think you're a suspect, they come in and they pick that. Okay, you have no expectation of privacy under the case law for leaving your DNA behind. So that's why when people throw away cigarettes, people eat something and leave it alone, or glasses or whatever, that is not protected by the Fourth Amendment. Another controversy dealt with dragnets. Actually, the first case in the UK in 1985 was a small village. They had a rape murder of a teenage girl, and 3 years later, they have a second rape murder of a teenage girl, and they think it's the same person. They actually get a confession, a false confession out of a guy who's a janitor. On the first, I think it was the first one, well, one of them, maybe it was the second, I'm not sure. But he wouldn't admit it to the second rape. He would not admit to that, but they got a confession out of the first one. He was, at least when I saw him on TV later, or film, he seemed to be cognitively impaired. That's why they got the false confession. So they hear about this DNA that Dr. Jeffries is doing at a nearby university, and so they send the DNA up to him. And he says, well, I got good news and bad news. Good news, the same person committed both rapes and murders. The bad news is not the guy you have arrested. So then they decide to do a dragnet in the area. Well, a dragnet is where they ask all the males to come in, or males of certain ages to come in and voluntarily give your DNA. What happened, the actual dragnet, they had, 3,000 people and stuff, or 6,000 in all these communities. People would come in and stuff, volunteer. They never found it that way. What happened is, because of the dragnet, the real culprit got concerned about it, and he got a friend of his to go in for him, doctored a passport. A person out of the area came in and took the test for him. So he was not picked up. Eventually, the guy who went in there kept telling people at bars, oh yeah, I took the test for somebody else. And somebody, finally the light went off, and told the police. We've had dragnets in the United States. They are controversial. The one in Charlottesville, Virginia, where the University of Virginia was, they were looking for a black male, so there's a racial component to that dragnet, asking people. The other thing, lawyers know that you don't have to consent, but a lot of people don't know when the police ask you, and certainly there's implied pressure there. And they really have not been all that successful. There was a case in on Cape Cod, where this woman was killed, and they started using a dragnet. And a lot of people just resented it. They just thought it was an invasion of their civil liberties to have the police show up outside of a Walmart or something and asking males for their DNA. Other people just volunteered to give it. They solved the case, not through the dragnet. That's the problem. Our success rate on dragnets aren't really great. They solved the case because one of the first things they did is they got consent from anybody who had a connection with the house. And one of the people who had a connection is the garbage collector. And the problem is they took the DNA from him. It sat at the lab, again, a backlog problem. So while they're doing all this dragnet and wasting all this time and money, they didn't test, so eventually they get around to testing it and they got their culprit right away. So the dragnet didn't work there. One of the places where it might work, if there's a crime that is committed in this room or in this building, or if you think out of a hospital or a mental institution where somebody is assaulted, and you ask for, you don't have probable cause for everybody if you don't have something more. So if you ask people to volunteer in that situation, then it could be helpful. But they have not proved to be very successful. You have to have a really small possible universe. All right. Are there any other questions about DNA that I can answer? Yes.
Process of DNA extraction being continually refined, or is there standard practice that you think will be around for the next decade or so?
Well, depends what you mean. The scientists use extraction, I think, in a more precise way. That is, once they have the cell or the biological tissue, they have to extract the DNA from the cell. So extraction is used that way. If you're talking about how we get it, they used to use blood, but now you use cheek swabs. So that's not very invasive. So they'll usually take the suspect or an offender population. They just use a cheek swab. They'll get enough DNA from that. Send it to the lab. The first thing they do is they extract the DNA out. Then they have to, the other powerful thing about the DNA is they can amplify it. They can make it copy itself and reproduce. So the original test, you need a quarter. Back in the late 80s, you'd need a blood spot or something the size of a quarter. Now all you need is, this is called touch DNA. I've just touched it, I left my DNA, they can get that. So they extract it, they amplify it. It's all automated now. They work through these machines, and then at the end you get that electropherogram. So it's very much automated. Where you see some of the new techniques where there's problems is when you try to use DNA you can get DNA from any living thing. So there are cases where they get DNA from a plant. There's a famous Arizona case, Palo Verde tree, I guess. Anyway, there's a tree by the murder scene and has seeds, and they find those seeds in the defendant's car, and so they, any living thing has it. So there are cases like that. They've done animal DNA to match, and people have pets. And so if there's a pet at a murder scene, or the defendant has a pet, cat, dog, you can use the DNA for that. There's, they've had an HIV case with a person tried to kill somebody else with a HIV virus. They were able to match that. In fact, the anthrax investigation at the same time around 9/11 was a DNA. Apparently anthrax, though, mutates so fast, it's not a very good subject.
Other than contamination and degradation of the
DNA sample, what other challenges would you make in the, the collection process or challenging DNA evidence?
It's easily contaminated. So you can cross contamination. So as I said, I'm leaving my DNA here. So if you come up and put your DNA there, then we've got more than one people. If I went through the Cuyahoga DNA lab, you can only go through, in the DNA lab, you can only go in one direction. You cannot backtrack. And the reason for that is they don't want you bringing DNA back. And they're in white suits and they have all these things. And so at some labs, they have everybody in the labs DNA in a quality control file, and all of a sudden they get the janitor's DNA in the case. They know they have a problem. So you're worried about contamination, cross-contamination, and so forth. I'm told I have to end at precisely now, but I will stay here and answer any of the questions that you may have. And thank you for coming.